live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasitharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banariamman Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasitharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay.
Oh. Recording in progress.
So, is it my screen is full screen to everyone?
Sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Jaywil, sir. And thank you all the participants and both Biozine and BPR Laboratory for having this guest lecture on a deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics. So, before entering into the topic, I hope you all have been there in this webinar series for the past 3 sessions. And I hope you would have got some basic insights on what is the evolution of SARS-CoV-2 and how to, what are all the various therapeutic approaches that we can explore to come up with this SARS-CoV-2. And then something like the vaccine technologies, the recent vaccine technologies in the case, right? And these are all, it's like how to handle those situation is what you have been seen in the previous talks. And my talk is like, I'm going to just focus upon deep on the various diagnostic approaches. So I hope that you people are very clear about the difference between therapeutics and diagnostics, right? So therapeutics are prophylaxis and then diagnostics. So only if you just can diagnose it easily or efficiently, then only you can go for further therapy or prophylaxis or vaccination or whatever it may be. It is based on how you diagnose the particular thing, right? So diagnosis is like a preliminary step. It's like a boundary for a cell which allows the other components in it, right? So if you want to go for therapy or if it is like for vaccination, whatever it may be, only if you have a very reliable and a very fast, economically suitable diagnostic technique, the pandemic or the particular disease or a particular condition could be handled in a very effective way. So whatever, not just in SARS-CoV-2, whatever the case, whatever the condition could be, let it be a cancer or let it could be other infections or let it could be some some genetic disorders, whatever it may be. The diagnosis has a very big role in all those detecting the presence of an abnormal condition rather than saying it as a disease, an abnormal condition. So detect it. So then once you detect and once you confirm the detection, then you can go for further treatment or whatever way you have to handle it, you can handle it in such a way, right? So diagnostics plays a vital role. And in same way, this pandemic COVID, diagnostics have a very vital role in handling this pandemic, right? So there are various technologies have been explored, and two basic parent technologies for any infectious disease was also played a major role in this SARS-CoV-2 diagnostic, right? So we will be seeing in detail about all those particular approaches in deep, and also we will be a little more exploring the recent technologies and some innovative approaches in which these conditions could be easily diagnosed, right? So the topic is, as it has been already mentioned, it's on a deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics. So I hope you all know that SARS-CoV-2 has created a complete changeover for all of our human race, right? So in this particular century, it has taken up at least 1 or 2 years of our entire lifetime, right? So it has a very big impact over human race. And we define it as in a term of COVID-19, so coronavirus disease 2019. So it emerged in 2019. So we kept a name it as COVID-19, right? So SARS-CoV-2 is the causative organism. So SARS, as you know, when you saw the evolution of this particular disease already, in the previous lecture, you might have been covered up with MERS, SARS-1 and all those, right? So it's a second version of SARS, but still it has a little more higher capability of transmission and all those things. Those are all some complications of the SARS-CoV-2, and which makes us to be very difficult to handle, right? So this is what the SARS-CoV-2 and what is COVID-19. So basic understanding is very important, right? So then comes SARS-CoV-2. So it's an enveloped single-stranded RNA genome. So 4 genera's coronavirus genera's are there: alpha corona, beta coronavirus, gamma corona, and there are different strains have also been isolated. And various source of this particular organism has been hypothesized, but still we are yet to confirm it, right? So, but still bats are seems to be the natural reservoir of SARS-CoV-2. And also people say that pangolins and turtles could be an intermediate host for this particular condition also, correct? So this is how it actually emerged. And if you see the overall spread of this particular thing at the starting, it's very huge, right? So it affected North America, and then if you see in most of the European countries and also in Asian countries, it has its occurrence, right? So it's like a global threat for us people. So it had a very big impact overall in commercial aspects and also in all other commercial psychological aspects. It has a very big impact, this SARS-CoV-2 or this COVID-19, whatever we say. So it has a huge occurrence throughout the globe, if you see the map, right? So United States, it has many cases, Brazil, UK, Italy, all those things. So SARS-CoV-2, as an insight, if you have to see, it's a novel coronavirus with a tremendous human-to-human transmission, right? So that's a transmission rate compared to the SARS-1, it has a very high transmission rate. And no previous exposure to it, so everyone is susceptible to it, right? So if it has been already exposed, then we would have got some more immunity so that we could easily easily resist it. But still, it is no previous exposure is there, so everyone is susceptible to this particular condition. So no known effect or preventive or therapeutic drug has been already discovered for this particular thing, and so this makes it very difficult to handle. And also, it is spreading widely, right? So due to this globalization, so it has a very huge spread and it has become something like a pandemic, right? So to tackle this, to handle this particular thing, diagnosis plays a very important role, right? So let me assume that it's a separate country we have, and the occurrence of this COVID is just picking up, right? So in this case, what is the rate of that transmission, and everything has to be diagnosed. Everything has to be studied, so that we can easily treat it or easily handle the condition as a global threat, right? So in that case, a diagnosis plays a very important role. So most prevailing technology for this diagnosis is like RT-PCR technique. So it's a reverse transcription PCR. And then we also have rapid antigen test assays. So the difference is that RT-PCR is slow, but it's gold standard for diagnosis, right? Because the accuracy level is a little more higher compared to the rapid antigen tests that we usually do. But it's a fast, but not that much as sensitive. It may give false negative results also. So once you diagnose it, so once you diagnose a particular individual having this particular infection, then the way that you can go for further handling the condition is all about with the prescription for containment, right? So we can contain it by various things like, so in this case, how to contain this? So in that case, diagnosis plays a vital role. So test them, trace them, and treat them. Right? So that means it's a complete set of isolation. So it's like a golden mantra for this handling this COVID pandemic, right? So at least to our country, it is like a complete mantra. That is how, and we have crossed this much level with this COVID pandemic, right? So, but not working effectively in halting, it is halting the spread, right? So we cannot do the, if diagnosis is not that much up to the mark, then it is very easy, very difficult for us to isolate or to treat or to test, right? So then it makes a very difficult thing, right? So then we will have another question. So why SARS-CoV-2 is spreading while SARS-CoV was contained? SARS-1 was actually contained, right? So it was easily, the spread was easily restricted, but still SARS-CoV-2 spreading was not that, it was not similar case of SARS, right? So it was like in 2003, when SARS first appeared, in 6 months, it caused 8,100 infections in restricted geographies like Hong Kong, Singapore, and Toronto. So in that case, like in 2003, when SARS-1 was there, the best thing that they have done was like symptom-based case detection and subsequent testing to guide, isolate, and quarantine. So that was one big thing. So it's like the symptom was very higher. It was easy to detect, right? But in case of SARS-CoV-2, if you have asymptomatic cases, which makes it a little more difficult to diagnose, right? So SARS-CoV-2 has many similarities to SARS, but what is that? High genetic relatedness to SARS-1, and then transmissible primarily through respiratory droplets, and frequent lower respiratory symptoms like cough, fever, and shortness of breath. And it has a median IP of 5 days. But SARS-CoV-2 is different and similar control efforts have not succeeded. This is because SARS-CoV-2 shed even before symptoms appear. That is the main thing. Whereas SARS, the viral shedding was seen only after the symptoms seems to be diagnosed to the patients, but SARS-CoV-2 is not in such a case. It has shed even before the symptoms appear. And 80% of the infectious people shedding virus are asymptomatic. So that's a very big case that I already told you. So symptom-based detection is very easy. If you diagnose a symptom, if you see a prevalence of a symptoms, then it is very easy for the physician to diagnose it. So to take him for diagnosis, so and then to test him, to take him under care and then to isolate him were very easy. But in case of asymptomatic condition or pre-symptomatic condition, it was very difficult to handle. That is what SARS-CoV-2 was very brilliant in handling human race, right? So it has asymptomatic conditions in which we could not easily diagnose the presence of the particle. And it has a very high transmission rate also. So the story is something like this. So it's like a blind man working with COVID-19, right? So we don't know what is there in the wild, and we don't know, we are completely blindfolded, and we use various technologies. We say BCG vaccine could control, and someone says no vaccine is there, plasma therapy is there, Ayurveda was there, yoga and medicine could take a good care, everything, many different suggestions and many different hypotheses was developed, but still whatever was there, we were still in a blind condition, right? So it was like blind man working with a COVID-19. So this picture, this image attracts me a lot on defining COVID-19. Still the case prevails. Even though we have been exposed to COVID and we are working with COVID, these scenarios for the past approximately just 2 years, right? So for the past 2 years, we have been with this COVID-19, but still we could not handle it in a correct way. We are trying, and the the next phase of that particular infection is coming. Still, researchers are working hard to take up this puzzle and to solve it. Okay? So the statistics, if you see in the previous case of the phase one, it was not that much up to the level. So this is a case study of Tamil Nadu. So if you see in the year of 2019 to 20, that particular era, it was like the phase four, we state it as phase one, right? It was not that much to the peak, but the phase two that we say it as, which happened at a month before, it was very high. So we could not even handle it, but still now we have taken it up to control due to various precautionary measures deployed by the government. But still, we don't know whether it is going to come back, or we can handle it, or we are over with it. We don't know, right? So the only goal mark approach to take this and to handle this particular condition is to go ahead with it. Like, even though we have various vaccination programs or various therapeutics we have in hand, but still it is not it is not applicable unless you cannot diagnose the condition at an early stage or a very rapid stage in a rapid way or in a very easy approach, right? So if you cannot diagnose it, then how are you going to treat it? You can vaccinate, but still you cannot treating or taking care or containing the spread is not that much possible, right? So only vaccination is possible. A prophylaxis could be given, but still we cannot, a preventive measure can be given, but we cannot just contain the spread, right? So, and also as a developing nation, we are not that much equipped commercially or financially, we are not that much equipped to vaccinate all of our population, right? So the government is taking necessary steps to vaccinate as much as soon as possible. But still, that is where diagnosis plays a vital, right? So if you see the contribution of transmissibility and severity of population impacted for various cases, various similar infections, so clinical severity versus transmittability, if you see the avian flu, which came in 1997, had a very high severe clinical severity, but transmissibility was very low. MERS, if you see, it had a very high clinical severity, but the transmissibility was not that much. The same way, H1N1 pandemic in 1918 to 1919 had a very higher impact, right? So it has higher clinical severity and a higher transmissibility. But how it actually succeeded, how it actually came up because of lower globalization. Now this SARS-CoV-2-19 has become as a pandemic because of the higher globalization. So transmissibility is also high. And if you see the clinical severity ranges from moderate to high. So, and due to easy globalization, it is easily spreading, and we term it as a complete pandemic. And which makes the government bodies to handle it in a very difficult scenario, correct? So there comes the need for diagnosis, right? So what could this diagnosis can do in handling this thing, right? So if it is not diagnosed, you don't know how it has been infected, and if you cannot diagnose it, so then you cannot isolate them, and you cannot treat them, and you cannot trace them, correct? Whereas if you have an appropriate and efficient diagnostic technique to detect the presence of that particular condition, then it makes very easy to trace them, track them, isolate them, treat them, right? So that is where the diagnosis comes up, has a very big role in this cases, right? So COVID-19 pandemic is a serious global health issue today due to the rapid human-to-human transmission, as we have already seen. So the early diagnosis is crucial to prevent the extensive spread of the disease. And we discuss in this particular presentation, we are going to discuss the various detection methods of SARS-CoV-2, whereas including serological or immunological assays, amplification techniques, as well as something about some biosensors we will be discussing. Okay. So to see an overall picture, you know, what is SARS-CoV-2 and what is its how it is made up of, right? So you all are aware of it's made up of a spike protein. It has a nucleocapsid in which it is an RNA-based single standard RNA virus, and it has some other envelope proteins, and then hemagglutinin esterase dimers, so which aids in attachment to the receptors. So it's a whole virion, right? So it's a complete virion which is very effective in attacking our respiratory cells, right? So has a very huge impact. So this is how it actually works, and this is how it actually creates a humoral immune response against the SARS-CoV-2. right? So you have the viral particle, it attaches to the host cell, and the host cell further goes with, so it will be further coated with antigen presenting cells, and then it will be further taken up with called antibodies, cytokines, and then further it will be treated. So this is how our humoral immune response will work against the SARS-CoV. So in this particular complete immune responses, we have many critical points in which you can take it up for diagnosis, right? So when actually the viral particle actually infects, there is a chance you can detect the particle, the antigen, so antigen detections, right? And when it causes some humoral immune responses, with that presence of those antibodies, they can diagnose it. Or you can diagnose it by the presence of the particular viral RNA. You can reverse transcribe it. You can take it to a cDNA level, and then you can diagnose it. So various critical points or various new points are there in which you can easily diagnose this SARS-CoV. But still, it requires some technical skills to do that, right? So that is where we are lagging. And recent technologies are being adapted. Advanced technologies are being adapted to tackle up this particular gap that has between the technical skill and the rapid effectiveness detection of that particular condition. So we are bridging the gap, but still completely it is not bridged. We are still trying various possibilities and waiting for various approvals, clinical approvals. Still research is going. Okay. So then comes how this infects. So understanding the infectious phase of a particular infection is very important to diagnose it, right? So in this case, for this particular condition of SARS-CoV-2, we can see three different phases, three different stages. So one particular stage is the early infection phase, and the second stage is the pulmonary infection phase, and then the third stage goes to the hyperinflammation. So stage one and stage two is like, stage two is like an intermediate phase in which the viral response phase, that means the antigen will be proliferating. So it's a viral responsive phase, the initial time. And then comes the stage two, in which stage two starting would be like, the first part of the thing would be like the host response phase. So now you have an antigen into your body, right? So now the host cell will have its immuno processes, right? So it will try to defend it, and it will have some inflammatory responses. So this is the two phases. So a particular diagnostic person can either explore any of these particular phases, right? So you can either explore the viral responsive phase, in which he can target, he can use antigens, the viral antigens as a biomarker, or he can use also host immune molecules like your antibodies as a biomarker. The presence of those antibodies is a biomarker. But when you see this picture, you can very easily understand that detecting at the viral response phases itself diagnosing the condition at the viral responsive phase could be a better approach, right? So because you are diagnosing it at the initial stage itself, rather than taking it to the second phase, that is the pulmonary phase, because only host inflammatory responses will start only after the second phase, right? So it is very logical, rather than saying it is technical. Logically, if you see earlier the detection, efficient will be the spread, right? So efficiently you can contain the spread. So earlier detection. So opening pathing, you can very easily understand that. So making a diagnostic technique at this particular viral responsive phase could give you a better result on containing your condition or the pandemic. So this is not only for COVID, it could be exploited for all conditions also. So you have various clinical symptoms, clinical signs on different phases. Okay. So researchers are going on that. But mostly if you see this serological based assays, they mostly serological in the sense indirect serological based assays mostly depend on this particular phase of host inflammatory response phase, whereas all your amplification based or non-serological direct approaches like your ELISA, that is antigen detection, direct antigen, not antibody detection, direct antigen spike protein detection, something like that, ELISA based approaches, and also so amplification, RT-PCRs, and then like biosensors, and something like your, other approaches like your sequencing techniques, right? So Nanopore has given you a broad way to sequence, and it has given a broad platform also to easily sequence. So Nanopore assisted targeted sequencing technique, NTS techniques, have been explored in this viral response. So these technology, that is why we say it does, even though RT-PCR takes time and it requires technical complexity and it has some technical complexities, it is widely explored because of its early detection, so that you can easily contain this. Okay. So this shows the occurrence of your biomarker. So as I've already told you, so in the viral response phase, you will have your viral antigens and your viral RNAs, which could be a potential biomarker for you to easily diagnose the presence of that particular infection, right? But as time goes, then only your serological assays could take up. That means in the host inflammatory response, right? So in that cases, you might have your immunoglobulins, Igs that has been secreted by your cells to tackle up. So it's a host immune response. So host immune biomolecules could also be taken as the biomarkers for detection of this particular source. But these type of biomarkers, that serological biomarkers like your antibodies, are a little more, it's not that much reliable data. We don't highly rely on that data that is given. It is like a false negative. So you need a confirmatory test in which we depend on RT-PCR basis. So early detection, you go for RT-PCR, but the complexity there in RT-PCR is very high. That is why you're not that much exploring. And in terms of commercial aspects also, it is not easy for a governmental body to easily public body to affair completely for a complete screening of its population using RT-PCR. It's not possible. So there are some complexities, there are some discrepancies over that also. So it is better to go ahead with the preliminary screening, which is a serological assay. So people mostly depend on these type of serological assays to have an initial diagnosis. Then they will depend on something like your RT-PCR based assays. So it depends. It depends on the condition. It depends on the decision of the physician taking it. So, but the thing that you have to understand is, the types of different types of biomarkers that you could easily exploit for your diagnostic procedure. Either you can depend on the antigen or you can depend on the antibodies that has been produced by the host. Correct? So these are all the different biomarkers. And if you see the characteristics, so this particular slide that I'm showing you here could very clearly explain you the various characteristics in which you can go ahead. So if you see the number, of this asymptomatic condition, it is around 20.8% of the patients come up with asymptomatic conditions. So symptomatic condition, if you see, it is somewhere around 141 cases. That is 79.2%. So this makes it very complex for handling, right? And also median days of viral shedding in case of asymptomatic is 19 days, where in case of symptomatic, it is 14 days for a taken group of 37 sample groups. So shortest days in case of asymptomatic. So asymptomatic is highly variable. So if you say it is varying between 6 to 45 days, correct? So you cannot easily have an overall picture about this asymptomatic condition, which makes it a little more complicated to handle the particular spread, right? And if you see the viral specific Ig, immunoglobulins, if you see it is present between a 3 to 4 weeks after exposure level, it is 30 out of 37 patients with a median of 3.4 and 31 out of 37 in symptomatic conditions. And also viral specific IgMs. So this IgMs could be for 23 out of 37 and 29 out of 37 in case of asymptomatic. So these relevant viral specific prevalence of this viral specific immunoglobulins could give you an easy picture on, or it could give you a confidence, it could increase the confidence level of selecting an serological assay, right? So then after 8 weeks of discharge, they have also tested various parameters that could be taken, right? So these are all some basic characteristics of this conditions. Now, coming up to our main topic, that is the various diagnostic approaches, if you see. So you can depend on, so first thing is you have to depend on what type of sample that you have. To have, like your respiratory sample could be taken or your blood samples could be taken, and also nowadays digital imaging could also be done to detect, but still there are some discrepancies that we will see in the next coming slides. So if you see LFI approaches, laminar flow immunoassays, and then ELISA based approaches to detect the antibodies and also detect something like your antigen molecules. Then you have your RT-PCR and then CRISPR based techniques, RT-LAM techniques, which is a rapid approach in detecting fluorescent detection approaches. And then NTS technology. So NTS has given a big impact over this diagnosis, but still it has not been open up to the public or normal usages, normal commercial usages. We have not exploited this NTS approaches. So NTS is nothing but your sequencing approaches, right? So NTS like nanopore assisted targeted sequencing technology. So, but still, nanopore has not been that much exploited by the government because of people dependency on the gold techniques like your RT-PCR and LFI approaches, right? And then we have biosensors also coming into pictures, but still it is not widely explored. So the main thing that has been explored is like ELISA, and then RT-PCR, and then LFI approaches, okay? So see, two things, if you have to see it as a whole picture, two basic. One is your serological and non-serological approaches. That's it. And something like CT scans are also been exploited. As I've already told you, imaging, bioimaging could also be used to detect the presence of this particular SARS-CoV. But there are various other complications that has to be taken care of when you process this imaging techniques. So it requires some interdisciplinary involvement, like digital image processing has to be taken into it so that you can easily diagnose it by CT scans, but still the complexity that we see here in this case of CT imaging, CT scan based imaging technique is like its similarity over other conditions, like other normal pneumonias, so adenoviral pneumonia. So how it is similar? So in that case, you have to analyze with a larger group of samples, which is not that much feasible at this particular pandemic condition, right? So significantly saying the difference between SARS-CoV-2 infections and CT images and also other CT images for other different infectious conditions. So that you need a higher group of samples so that you can easily compare and do a particular machine learning algorithms to easily diagnose, right? Anyhow, these are all the digital image processing techniques, right? So CT scan based approaches. And a crazy thing is like now dogs are also being used today. Researchers in US, they have been working with dogs, which they term it as biodetection dogs or medical detection dogs, in which they use them or exploit them for, explore them for diagnosing the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in patients' respiratory samples. So, but still, these are all not been open to access for everyone. Researchers are exploring it. People are exploring. Scientists are exploring it. But due to some unavailability of relevant and appropriate data, we could not exploit these technologies to public, right? But still, these are all various technologies that people are exploring, scientists are exploring. So that is what I showed this image, right? So diagnosis. So this is what is diagnosis. The basic common techniques that we exploit, I have given at the top, like rapid antigen and rapid antibody assays. And then RT-PCR based assay, which is taken as a gold standard approach. And then immune enzymatic serological tests, right? Like your ELISA based approaches that people depend on. So these three techniques are widely explored in nowadays, the current scenario throughout the globe. But before this, there were the need of this much diagnosis, when the SARS-CoV-2 was in a research state or in a primary phase, there were various other detection techniques like your viral culture based detection, the next gen sequencing, radiological investigations, clinical examination. So these are all like basic techniques that people were exploring when these rapid antigen or RT-PCR based assays or immune enzymatic serological assays has took up its market. So these are all like laboratory, basic scientific research laboratory experiments. But now people have gone into other integrated technologies like isothermal amplification techniques, cryo-electron microscopies, CRISPR-Cas9 based diagnostic methods, droplet digital PCR techniques, biosensors, FET based techniques. So many, many, many different approaches has been exploited, but still not taken up to the market. That is the issue. That is the gap. Because of various regulatory bodies, various authentic data that we have to get, so that unavailability, we could not easily exploit this technique in normal conditions. Okay. So this image I've already shown you, right? So this, the onset of your biomarkers. So how you can select the biomarkers, and based on the prevalence of the biomarkers from the day of the symptom, how can you exploit this using different diagnostic approaches is what we have to see, right? So once you get the viral contact, it is not, you are not taking it to the host immune response phase. You are only in the viral response, right? So in that case, you will have the presence of your viral antigens, and then the viral antigens, like your its protein molecules, surface proteins, and then its nucleic acids like RNA, right? So you can either exploit that in the viral responsive phase. So to exploit this RNA, you have to change it into cDNA, because RNA is not that much stable. So better go for reverse transcribing, right? So then you go for cDNA. With that cDNA, you can amplify it. And then that is what RTPC, right? So you reverse transcribe, and then you go for your amplification process, based fluorescent-based detection, like you can use Pac-Man probes, or you can see for amplification, just amplification, fluorescent amplifications, or some sequence-specific primers, something like that. You can do it, and this is like an diagnosis that you take care in a viral response phase via the nucleic acid biomolecules, right? You can also exploit other biomolecules like your spike proteins and other relevant proteins, ORF proteins, something like those proteins. You can use it as a biomarker. Those are also direct technology, direct diagnosis approaches. Okay? So even though they are not nucleic acid, they are also termed as direct diagnostic approaches, because you're directly diagnosing the presence of that particular antigen, the particular infective organism, right? So it's also biomolecule. It's also an integral part of the viral molecule, right? So it could be easily exploited. So then comes, once the host immune response phase picks up, so once it is in the infectious phase, at the middle of the infectious phase, the host immune response actually takes, right? So in that case, you will have prevalence of your host immune cell, your host immune biomarkers, like your immunoglobulins, IgM, IgG, IgA, and all those things, which could also be exploited, because all these Igs are very specific to your particular infectious organism. So it could give you a positive results also, but still you cannot easily depend, because it's an indirect approach. You are not directly diagnosing the particular viral molecule, rather than you're indirectly diagnosing it by the presence of your viral molecule, your immunoglobulins have been generated. So it's a host immune response. So that host immune response, by diagnosing the presence of host immune response, we easily diagnose the presence of that condition. So that is it's like an indirect approach, right? So most of the serological assays that we do, like your laminar flow immunoassays, all those kind of assays are like indirect approach. Serological, basically they will go for indirect, because you are taking a sample from the host, right? So it is like an indirect host immune response biomolecules, you are taking it as a biomarkers. So it is an indirect approach. Whereas if you directly take the biomarkers that is prevailing in the causative organism, like your SARS-CoV-2, like its RNA, its nucleic acid, or its surface proteins like spike or something else, then it comes something like a direct diagnostic approach, like your antigen detection and antibody detection. So this is an easy representation. So this is what I was explaining you about all these direct detection approaches, like ELISA, Western blot could be explored, lateral flow assays, it is very specifically for the viral proteins, not your antibodies. So lateral flow assays could be exploited in both ways, both in direct detection technique and also in indirect detection technique. Okay, so direct detection technique, if you're exploiting this lateral flow assays, lateral flow immunoassays, it should not be as lateral flow immunoassays, right? So in this case, it is lateral flow assays. We're just diagnosing the presence of your viral molecules, like your viral spike protein, envelope proteins, nucleocapsid proteins, membrane glycoproteins, or lipidic membranes, something like that. If you're going to diagnose that using this lateral flow approaches, then that stage. So lateral flow approaches, I hope you all know. Your pregnancy kit is a very good example of lateral flow diagnostics, right? So that is what we see it in direct detection methods, correct? And also you can go for RT, that is reverse transcription based PCR methods, sequencing approaches. Right? You depend on various viral RNA molecules. And then, so you detect the viral components directly. So that is what we call it as direct detection methods, right? So then comes your indirect detection methods in which you detect the presence of your host immune response, right? So your host immune response in the sense, as we have already told you, rather than the detection of the antigen directly, you depend on its immune response, the biomolecules. So in that case also, you can depend on lateral flow assays, like your lateral flow. In this case, you can say it as LTIA. In the previous case, we were saying it as LFA. In this case, you can say it as LFIA, correct? Lateral flow immunosorbent assays, immunoassays. So in this case, you are going to diagnose the presence of the indirect biomarkers like your immune cells, your immune immunoglobulins, immune biomolecules. So how will your immune response has been taken up? So based on that, based on the mechanism of antibody detection, you can take it up. So these are all, so to diagnose this antibodies, the presence of these antibodies in your sample, you have to take the sample as serum, right? Rather than the nasal sample, you have to take your serum. That is what we term it as. So most of the indirect detection methods are said as serological assays. But still, serological assays can also be done in direct way, in which you take the biomarker as the antigens, biomolecules. I hope I'm clear, right? So this is the difference between direct detection approaches and indirect detection approaches. Okay, so now coming into the serological. So as I've already told you, serological is nothing but the presence of your host immune response biomolecule, that is your antibodies. So in that case, the occurrence, as we have already mentioned in the previous case, from the day of infection, you can see, if you see the overall graph, would have a viral responsive phase up to a date of somewhere around some 10 days or 10 to 14 days, it will take up to the viral responsive phase. After that, the host response phase starts. So this picture very clearly shows you what is the relative quantity of your antibodies, right? And titer values. So you can easily see after the 10th day, it is picking up in both critical cases and non-critical cases. So this is a particular paper, research work that has been published in Nature Medicine. So it's a clinical and immunological assessment of asymptomatic SARS-CoV-2 infections. So if you see in that case, this particular left side image that I'm showing you here is showing it for asymptomatic and symptomatic cases on the relative level of viral RNA. So this comes under your non-serological assays, that is your direct approaches. Whereas the right side image that I'm showing is completely with the indirect, that is the host immune response. So it is like the log fold of immunoglobulins levels for both symptomatic conditions and the asymptomatic conditions for acute phase and convalescent phases. So the total sample size that they have taken is 37. So it's a very reliable data, if you see, because both the sample numbers are very equal. So this is how you can go for detection. So you can take it up in that way. Okay. So for coming up to serological assays, that's we have already, but why we depend on, we say this many problems in serological assays, that is your indirect approaches. But still, why we do it? Because of its easiness, its low technical complexity. Even though we cannot say it as a nil technical complexity, we can only say it as low technical complexity, right? So how it infects? So this particular antigen has to go and bind to something called as an AC2 receptor. Then only it can infect the host cell. So it's like an entry gate, right? So, but still, there are some immunomolecules like immunoglobulins could be exploited to stop the entry of that particular SARS-CoV-2 into your host, right? So you can either exploit that presence. So this is what is immunity, that is, humoral immunity, that is. So exploring that antibodies, so these antibodies will be present in your serum, right? So you take that as a biomarker and you detect and you diagnose the presence of that particular condition, then that we say it as serological assays. So variations in SARS-CoV-2 serological diagnostic tests, like lateral flow assays that we have already seen, and then enzyme immunosorbent assays, ELISA, and then chemical immunoassays, right? And then specimen types, most widely explored specimen types are serum, plasmas, and then finger sticks or venous whole blood samples. So blood samples could also be exploited. Immunoglobulin class that has been detected are IgM, IgG, IgA, and total antibodies are also detected in cases. So the CDC COVID-19 guidelines of 2020, May 23, says that no advantage testing for IgG, IgM, and IgG are total. So testing for IgA are not recommended actually. So SARS-CoV-2 antigen used as spike protein, receptor binding domains, and then nucleocapsid. So this is for direct assays, direct serological assays. You can depend on S1 or S2 of the spike protein, and then nuclear receptor, RBD domains, and then a nucleocapsid. So most abundant variety, so capsid. So these are all some various SARS-CoV-2 serological test designs that people depend on. Okay. So the current SARS-CoV-2 antibody test status is like currently around 190 commercially available serological tests for SARS-CoV-2 have been approved. So 15 with the emergency use authorization EUA granted by FDA, US FDA. And remaining have been submitted for EUA, that is emergency usages. So only 15 has been exploited for emergency usages. And 31 serological test manufacturers either did not receive or submit the EUA. And no antibody tests are approved for at home or point of care usages. Still in India, there were cases before 1 month in which a particular manufacturer told that we have a POC, that is point of care usage test, but still it has not been commercially approved. Because of various regulatory efforts, right? So alternative or non-venipuncture collection methods are increasingly being investigated. So the diagnosis, you have various stages like sample collection, and then sample, you take your bio extraction of your biomarker from the sample is itself a very tedious task. And then to safely transport it to the laboratory. So a normal diagnostic approach is like a tedious process. Sample extraction is a very crucial stage, and then extracting your biomolecule, biomarker from your sample is a very crucial stage. Then taking that or preserving that in until your assay starts is a very difficult stage, and then defining a very specific assay, very accurate or a very efficient assay is also different, right? So in that case, POCs, like point of care usages, could your way, right? In terms of transportation, storing your biomolecule with a higher care, it could be a little more reduced. That is why we explore those type of POCs. But still, point of care usage types of reduction approaches has not been widely explored or not been widely commercialized. In case as an expert, we are exploring a lot, but still, it is not commercially exploited. It's not commercially available for people. So various investigations have been there. So if you are a little more interested in this diagnosis, you can mostly depend on, you can do your research work at this initial stage of diagnosis, like your sample collection, transportation, preserving, POC types of models. So rather than taking it, you create a new approach of diagnosis, better if you are Is it my screen is full screen to everyone?
Sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Jaywill, sir. And thank you all the participants and both Biozine and BPR Laboratory for having this guest lecture on a deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics. So before entering into the topic, I hope you all have been there in this webinar series for the past 3 sessions. And I hope you would have got some basic insights on what is the evolution of SARS-CoV-2 and how to, what are all the various therapeutical approaches that we can explore to come up with this SARS-CoV-2. And then something like the vaccine technologies, the recent vaccine technologies in the case, right? And these are all, it's like how to handle those situation is what you have been seen in the previous talks. And my talk is, like I'm going to just focus upon deep on the various diagnostic approaches. So I hope that you people are very clear about the difference between therapeutics and diagnostics, right? So therapeutics are prophylaxis, and then diagnostics. So only if you just can diagnose the easily or efficiently, then only you can go for further therapy or prophylaxis or vaccination or whatever it may be. It is based on how you diagnose the particular thing, right? So diagnosis is like a preliminary step. It's like a boundary for a cell which allows the other components in it, right? So if you want to go for therapy or if it is like for vaccination, whatever it may be, only if you have a very reliable and a very fast, economically suitable diagnostic technique, the pandemic or the particular disease or a particular condition could be handled in a very effective way. So whatever, not just in SARS-CoV-2, whatever the case, whatever the condition could be, let it be a cancer, or let it could be other infections, or let it could be some genetic disorders, whatever it may be. So diagnosis has a very big role in all those detecting the presence of an abnormal condition rather than saying it as a disease, an abnormal condition. So detect it. So then once you detect and once you confirm the detection, then you can go for further treatment or whatever way you have to handle it, you can handle it in such a way, right? So diagnostics plays a vital role. And in same way, this COVID and this pandemic COVID, diagnostics have a very vital role in handling this pandemic, right? So there are various technologies have been explored, and two basic parent technologies for any infectious disease was also played a major role in this SARS-CoV-2 diagnostic, right? So we will be seeing in detail about all those particular approaches in deep. And also we will be a little more exploring the recent technologies and some innovative approaches in which these conditions could be easily diagnosed, right? So the today's topic is, as it has been already mentioned, it's on a deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics. So I hope you all know that SARS-CoV-2 has created a complete changeover for all of our human race, right? So in this particular century, it has taken up at least 1 or 2 years of our entire lifetime, right? So it has a very big impact over human race. And we define it as in a term of COVID-19, so coronavirus disease 2019. So it emerged in 2019. So we kept a name it as COVID-19, right? So SARS-CoV-2 is the causative organism. So SARS, as you know, when you saw the evolution of this particular disease already in the previous lecture, you might have been covered up with MERS, SARS-1 and all those, right? So it's a second version of SARS, but still it has a little more higher capability of transmission and all those things. Those are all some complications of this SARS-CoV-2, and which makes us to be very difficult to handle, right? So this is what the SARS-CoV-2 and what is COVID-19. So basic understanding is very important, right? So then comes SARS-CoV-2. So it's an enveloped single-stranded RNA genome. So four geniras, coronavirus geniras are there, alpha corona, beta coronavirus, gamma corona, and there are different strains have also been isolated. And various source of this particular organism has been hypothesized, but still we are yet to confirm it, right? So, but still bats are seems to be the natural reservoir of SARS-CoV-2. And also people say that pangolins and turtles could be an intermediate host for this particular condition also, correct? So this is how it actually emerged. And if you see the overall spread of this particular thing at the starting, it's very huge, right? So it affected North America. And then if you see in most of the European countries and also the Asian countries, it has its occurrence, right? So it's like a global threat for us people. So it had a very big impact overall in commercial aspects and also in all other commercial, psychological aspects. It has a very big impact, this SARS-CoV-2 or this COVID-19, whatever we say. So it has a huge occurrence throughout the globe if you see the map, right? So United States, it has many cases, Brazil, UK, Italy, all those things. So SARS-CoV-2 as an insight, if we have to see, it's a novel coronavirus with a tremendous human-to-human transmission, right? So that's a transmission rate compared to the SARS-1, it has a very high transmission rate, and no previous exposure to it, so everyone is susceptible to it, right? So if it has been already exposed, then we would have got some moral immunity so that we could easily easily resist it, but still it is no previous exposure is there, so everyone is susceptible to this particular condition. So no known effect or preventive or therapeutic drug has been already discovered for this particular thing. And so this makes it very difficult to handle. And also it is spreading widely, right? So due to this globalization, so it has a very huge spread and it has become something like a pandemic, right? So to tackle this, to handle this particular thing, diagnosis plays a very important role, right? So let we assume that it's a separate country we have, and the occurrence of this COVID is just picking up, right? So in this case, what is the rate of that transmission, and everything has to be diagnosed, everything has to be studied, so that we can easily treat it or easily handle the condition as a global threat, right? So in that case, a diagnosis plays a very important role. So most prevailing technology for this diagnosis is like RT-PCR technique. So it's a reverse transcription PCR. And then we also have rapid antigen test assays. So the difference is that RT-PCR is slow, but it's gold standard for diagnosis, right? Because the accuracy level is a little more higher compared to the rapid antigen tests that we usually do. But it's a fast, but not that much as sensitive. It may give false negative results also. So once you diagnose it, so once you diagnose a particular individual having this particular infection, then the way that you can go for further handling the condition is all about with the prescription for containment, right? So we can contain it by various things like, so in this case, how to contain this? So in that case, diagnosis plays a vital role. So test them, trace them, and treat them. Right? So that means it's a complete set of isolation. So it's like a golden mantra for this handling this COVID pandemic, right? So at least to our country, it is like a complete mantra. That is how, and we have crossed this much level with this COVID pandemic, right? So, but not working effectively in halting, it is halting the spread, right? So we cannot do the, if diagnosis not that much up to the mark, then it is very easy, very difficult for us to isolate or to treat or to test, right? So then it makes a very difficult thing, right? So then we will have another question. So why SARS-CoV-2 is spreading while SARS-CoV-1 was contained? SARS-1 was actually contained, right? So it was easily, the spread was easily restricted, but still SARS-CoV-2 spreading was not that, it was not similar case of SARS, right? So it was like in 2003, when SARS first appeared, in 6 months, it caused 8,100 infections in restricted geographies like Hong Kong, Singapore, and Toronto. So what worked was in that case, like in 2003, when SARS-1 was there, the best thing that they have done was like symptom-based case detection and subsequent testing to guide, isolate, and quarantine. So that was one big thing. So they easily, it's like the symptom was very higher. It was easy to detect, right? But in case of SARS-CoV-2, if you have asymptomatic cases, which makes it a little more difficult to diagnose, right? So SARS-CoV-2 has many similarities to SARS, but what is that? High genetic relatedness to SARS-1, and then transmissible primarily through respiratory droplets, and frequent lower respiratory symptoms like cough, fever, and shortness of breath. And it has a median IP of 5 days. But SARS-CoV-2 is different, and similar control efforts have not succeeded. This is because SARS-CoV-2 shed even before symptoms appear. That is the main thing. Whereas SARS, the viral shedding was seen only after the symptoms seems to be diagnosed to the patients, but SARS-CoV-2 is not in such a case. It has shed even before the symptoms appears. And 80% of the infectious people shedding virus are asymptomatic. So that's a very big case that I already told you. So symptom-based detection is very easy. If you diagnose a symptom, if you see a prevalence of a symptoms, then it is very easy for the physician to diagnose it. So to take him for diagnosis, so and then to test him, to take him under care, and then to isolate him is very easy. But in case of asymptomatic condition or pre-symptomatic condition, it was very difficult to handle. That is what SARS-CoV-2 was very brilliant in handling human race, right? So it has asymptomatic conditions in which we could not easily diagnose the presence of the particle. And it has a very high transmission rate also. So the story is something like this. So it's like a blind man working with COVID-19, right? So we don't know what is there in the wild, and we don't know, we are completely blindfolded, and we use various technologies. We say BCG vaccine put control, and someone says no vaccine is there, plasma therapy is there, Ayurveda was there, yoga and medicine could take a good care, everything. Many different suggestions and many different hypotheses was developed, but still, whatever was there, we were still in a blind condition, right? So it was like blind man working with a COVID-19. So this picture, this image attracts me a lot on defining COVID-19. Still the case provides, even though we have crossed, we have been exposed to COVID and we are working with COVID, these scenarios for the past approximately, it is 2 years, right? So for the past 2 years, we are been with this COVID-19, but still we could not handle it in a correct way. We are trying, and the next phase of that particular infection is coming. Still, researchers are working hard to take up this puzzle and to solve it. Right? So the statistics, if you see, in the previous case of the phase one, it was not that much up to the level. So this is a case study of Tamil Nadu. So if you see in the year of 2019 to 20, that particular era, it was like phase four, we stated as phase one, right? It was not that much to the peak, but the phase two that we say it as, which happened at a month before, it was very high. So we could not even handle it, but still now we have taken it up to control due to various precautionary measures deployed by the government. But still, we don't know whether it is going to come back, or we can handle it, or we are over with it. We don't know, right? So the only goal mark approach to take this and to handle this particular condition is to go ahead with it. Like, even though we have various vaccination programs or various therapeutics we have in hand, but still it is not applicable unless you cannot diagnose the condition at a early stage or a very rapid stage in a rapid way or in a very easy approach, right? So if you cannot diagnose it, then how are you going to treat it? You can vaccinate, but still you cannot treating are taking care or containing the spread is not that much possible, right? So only vaccination is possible. A prophylaxis could be given, but still we cannot, a preventive measure can be given, but we cannot just contain the spread, right? So, and also as a developing nation, we are not that much equipped commercially or financially, we are not that much equipped to vaccinate all of our population, right? So the government is taking necessary steps to vaccinate as much as soon as possible. But still, that is where diagnosis plays a vital, right? So if you see the contribution of transmissibility and severity of population impacted for various cases, various similar infections, so clinical severity versus transmittability, if you see the avian flu, which came in 1997, had a very high severe clinical severity, but transmissibility was very low. MERS, if you see, it had a very high clinical severity, but the transmissibility was not that much. The same way, H1N1 pandemic in 1918 to 1919 had a very higher impact, right? So it has higher clinical severity and a higher transmissibility. But how it actually succeeded, how it actually came up because of lower globalization. Now this SARS-CoV-2-19 has become as a pandemic because of the higher globalization. So transmissibility is also high. And if you see the clinical severity ranges from moderate to high. So, and due to easy globalization, it is easily spreading, and we term it as a complete pandemic, and which makes the government bodies to handle it in a very difficult scenario, correct? So there comes the need for diagnosis, right? So what could this diagnosis can do in handling this thing, right? So if it is not diagnosed, you don't know how it has been infected, and if you cannot diagnose it, so then you cannot isolate them, and you cannot treat them, and you cannot trace them, correct? Whereas if you have an appropriate and efficient diagnostic technique to detect the presence of that particular condition, then it makes very easy to trace them, track them, isolate them, treat them, right? So that is where the diagnosis comes up, has a very big role in this cases, right? So COVID-19 pandemic is a serious global health issue today due to the rapid human-to-human transmission, as we have already seen. So the early diagnosis is crucial to prevent the extensive spread of the disease. And we discuss in this particular presentation, we are going to discuss the various detection methods of SARS-CoV-2, whereas including serological or immunological says amplification techniques, as well as something about some biosensors we'll be discussing. Okay. So to see an overall picture, you know, what is source photo and what is its, how it is made up of, right? So you all are aware of it's made up of a spike protein. It has a nucleocapsid in which it is an RNA-based single standard RNA virus. And it has some other enveloped proteins and then hemagglutinin esterase dimers. So which aids in the attachment to the receptors. So it's a whole virion, right? So it's a complete virion, which is very effective in attacking our respiratory cells, right? So it has a very huge impact. So this is how it actually works. And this is how it actually create an humoral immune response against the SARS-CoV-2, right? So you have the viral particle, it attaches to the host cell and the host cell further goes with, so it will be further coated with antigen presenting cells. And then it will be further taken up with called antibodies, cytokines, and then further it will be treated. So this is how our humoral immune response will work against the SARS-CoV. So in this particular complete immune responses, we have many critical points in which you can take it up for diagnosis, right? So when actually the viral particle actually infects, there is a chance you can detect the particle, the antigen, so antigen detections, right? And when it causes some humoral immune responses, with that presence of those antibodies, they can diagnose it. Or you can diagnose it by the presence of the particular viral RNA. You can reverse transcribe it. You can take it to a CDNA level and then you can diagnose it. So various critical points or various nuke points are there in which you can easily diagnose this SARS-CoV-2. But still, it's a skill. It requires some technical skills to do that, right? So that is where we are lagging. And recent technologies are being adapted, advanced technologies are being adapted to tackle up this particular gap that has between the technical skill and the rapid effectiveness detection of that particular condition. So we are bridging the gap, but still completely it is not bridged. We are still trying various possibilities and waiting for various approvals, clinical approvals. Still research is going. Okay. So then comes how this infects. So understanding the infectious phase of a particular infection is very important to diagnose it, right? So in this case, for this particular condition of SARS-CoV-2, we can see three different phases, three different stages. So one particular stage is the early infection phase, and the second stage is the pulmonary infection phase, and then the third stage goes to the hyperinflammation. So stage one and stage two is like, stage two is like an intermediate phase in which the viral response phase, that means the antigen will be proliferating. So it's a viral responsive phase, the initial time. And then comes the stage two, in which stage two starting would be like, the first part of the thing would be like the host response phase. So now you have an antigen into your body, right? So now the host cell will have its immuno processes, right? So it will try to defend it and it will have some inflammatory responses. So this is the two phases. So a particular diagnostic person can either explore any of these particular phases, right? So you can either explore the viral responsive phase in which you can target, you can use antigens, the viral antigens as a biomarker, or you can use also the host immune molecules like your antibodies as a biomarker. The presence of those antibodies is a biomarker. But when you see this picture, you can very easily understand that detecting at the viral response phases itself is could be so detecting the diagnosing the condition at the viral responsive phase could be a better approach, right? So because you are diagnosing it at the initial stage itself rather than taking it to the second phase, that is the pulmonary phase, because only host inflammatory responses will start only after the second phase, right? So it is very logical, rather than saying it is technical. Logically, if you see earlier the detection, efficient will be the spread, right? So efficiently you can contain the spread. So earlier detection. So opening path, you can very easily understand that. So making a diagnostic technique at this particular viral responsive phase could give you a better result on containing your condition or the pandemic. So this is not only for COVID, it could be exploited for all conditions also. So you have various clinical symptoms, clinical size, clinical signs on different phases. Okay? So researchers are going on that. But mostly if you see this serological based assays, they mostly serological in the sense indirect serological based assays mostly depend on this particular phase of host inflammatory response phase, whereas all your amplification based or non-serological direct approaches like your ELISA, that is antigen detection, direct antigen, not antibody detection, direct antigen spike protein detection, something like that, ELISA based approaches, and also amplification, RT-PCRs, and then like biosensors, and something like your, other approaches like your sequencing techniques, right? So Nanopore has given you a broad way to sequence, and it has given a broad platform also to easily sequence. So Nanopore assisted targeted sequencing technique, NTS techniques have been explored in this viral response. So these technology, that is why we say it is, even though RT-PCR takes time and it requires technical complexity and it has some technical complexities, it is widely explored because of its early detection. So that you can easily contain this. Okay. So this shows the occurrence of your biomarkers. As I've already told you, in the viral response phase, you will have your viral antigens and your viral RNAs, which could be a potential biomarker for you to easily diagnose the presence of that particular infection, right? But as time goes, then only your serological assays could take up. That means in the host inflammatory response, right? So in that cases, you might have your immunoglobulins, Igs that is being secreted by your cells to tackle up. So it's a host immune response. So host immune biomolecules could also be taken as a biomarkers for detection of this particular source. But these type of biomarkers, that serological biomarkers like antibodies, are a little more, it's not that much reliable data. We don't highly rely on the data that is given. It is like a false negative. So you need a confirmatory test in which we depend on RT-PCR basis. So early detection, you go for RT-PCR, but the complexity there in RT-PCR is very high. That is why you're not that much exploring. And in terms of commercial aspects also, it is not easy for a governmental body to easily public body to affair completely for a complete screening of its population using RT-PCR. It's not possible. So there are some complexities. There are some discrepancies over that also. So it is better to go ahead with the preliminary screening, which is a serological assay. So people mostly depend on these type of serological assays to have an initial diagnosis. Then they will depend on something like your RT-PCR based assays. So it depends. It depends on the condition. It depends on the decision of the physician taking it. So, but the thing that you have to understand is the different types of biomarkers that you could easily exploit for your diagnostic procedure. Either you can depend on the antigen or you can depend on the antibodies that has been produced by the host. Correct? So these are all the different biomarkers. And if you see the characteristics, so this particular slide that I'm showing you here could very clearly explain you the various characteristics in which you can go ahead. So if you see the number of this asymptomatic condition, it is around 20.8% of the patients come up with asymptomatic conditions. So symptomatic condition, if you see, it is somewhere around 141 cases. That is 79.2%. So this makes it very complex for handling, right? And also median days of viral shedding in case of asymptomatic is 19 days, where in case of symptomatic, it is 14 days for a taken group of 37 sample groups. So shortest days in case of asymptomatic. So asymptomatic is highly variable. So if you say it is varying between 6 to 45 days, correct? So you cannot easily have an overall picture about this asymptomatic condition, which makes it a little more complicated to handle the particular spread, right? And if you see the viral specific Ig immunoglobulins, if you see it is present between a 3 to 4 weeks after exposure level, it is 30 out of 37 patient with a median of 3.4 and 31 out of 37 in symptomatic conditions. And also viral specific IgMs, So this IgMs could be for 37, 23 out of 37 and 29 out of 37 in case of asymptomatic. So these relevant viral specific prevalence of this viral specific immunoglobulins could give you a easy picture on, or it could give you a it could increase the confidence level of selecting an serological assays, right? So then after 8 weeks of discharge, they have also tested various parameters that could be taken, right? So these are all some basic characteristics of this conditions. Now, coming up to our main topic, that is the various diagnostic approaches, if you see. So you can depend on, so first thing is you have to depend on what type of sample that you have to have, like your respiratory sample could be taken or your blood samples could be taken. And also nowadays, digital imaging could also be done to detect, but still there are some discrepancies that we will see in the next coming slides. So if you see LFI approaches, laminar flow immunoassays, and then ELISA based approaches to detect the antibodies and also detect something like your antigen molecules. Then you have your RT-PCR and then CRISPR based techniques, RT-LAM techniques, which is a rapid approach in detecting fluorescent detection approaches. And then NTS technology. So NTS has given a big impact over this diagnosis, but still it has not been open up to the public or normal usages, normal commercial usages. We have not exploited this NTS approaches. So NTS is nothing but your sequencing approaches, right? So NTS, like nanopore assisted targeted sequencing technology. So, but still nanopore has not been that much exploited by the government because of people dependency on the gold techniques like your RT-PCR and LFI approaches, right? And then we have biosensors also coming into pictures, but still it is not widely explored. So the main thing that has been explored is like ELISA, and then RT-PCR, and then LFA. Okay. So two things. If you have to see it as a whole picture, two basic things. One is your serological and non-serological approaches. That's it. And something like CT scans are also been exploited. As I've already told you, imaging, bioimaging could also be used to detect the presence of this particular SARS-CoV. But there are various other complications that has to be taken care of when you process this imaging techniques. So it requires some interdisciplinary involvement, like digital image processing has to be taken into it so that you can easily diagnose, you can easily diagnose it by CT scans. But still the complexity that we see here in this case of CT imaging, CT scan based imaging technique is like its similarity over other conditions, like other normal pneumonias, so adenoviral pneumonia. So how it is similar. So in that case, you have to analyze with a larger group of samples, which is not that much feasible at this particular pandemic condition, right? So significantly saying the difference between SARS-CoV-2 infections and CT images and also other CT images for other different infectious conditions. So that you need a higher group of samples so that you can easily compare and do a particular machine learning algorithms to easily diagnose, right? Anyhow, these are all the image, digital image processing techniques, right? So CT scan based approaches. And a crazy thing is like, now dogs are also being used today. Researchers in US, they have been working with dogs, which they term it as biodetection dogs or medical detection dogs, in which they use them or exploit them for, explore them for diagnosing the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in patients' respiratory samples. So, but still, these are all not been open to access for everyone. Researchers are exploring it. People are exploring. Scientists are exploring it. But due to some unavailability of relevant and appropriate data, we could not exploit these technologies to public, right? But still, these are all various technologies that people are exploring. Scientists are exploring. So that is what I showed this images, right? So diagnosis. So this is what is diagnosis. The basic common techniques that we exploit, I have given at the top, like your rapid antigen and rapid antibody assays, and then RT-PCR based assay, which is taken as a gold standard approach, and then immune enzymatic serological tests, right? Like your ELISA based approaches that people depend on. So these three techniques are widely explored in nowadays, the current scenario throughout the globe.
But before this, there were the need of this much diagnosis, when the SARS-CoV-2 was in a research state or in a primary phase, there were various other detection techniques like your viral culture-based detection, the next-gen sequencing, radiological investigations, clinical examination. So these are all like basic techniques that people were exploiting, were exploring when these rapid antigen or RT-PCR-based assays or immune enzymatic serological assays has took up its market. So these are all like laboratory, basic scientific research laboratory experiments. But now people have gone into other integrated technologies like isothermal amplification techniques, cryo-electron microscopies, CRISPR-Cas9-based diagnostic methods, droplet digital PCR techniques, biosensors, FET-based techniques. So many different approaches has been exploited, but still not taken up to the market. That is the issue. That is the gap. Because of various regulatory bodies, various authentic data that we have to get, so that unavailability, we could not easily exploit this technique in normal conditions. Okay. So this image I have already shown you, right? So this the onset of your biomarkers. So how you can select the biomarkers, and based on the prevalence of the biomarkers from the day of the symptom, how can you exploit this using different diagnostic approaches is what we have to see, right? So once you get the viral contact, it is not, you are not taking it to the host immune response phase. You are only in the viral response, right? So in that case, you will have the presence of your viral antigens, and then the viral antigens like your its protein molecules, surface proteins, and then its nucleic acids like RNA, right? So you can either exploit that in the viral responsive phase. So to exploit this RNA, you have to change it into cDNA, because RNA is not that much stable. So better go for reverse transcribing, right? So then you go for cDNA. With that cDNA, you can amplify it. And then that is what RT-PC, right? So you reverse transcribe, and then you go for your amplification procedure. Based fluorescent-based detection, like you can use Pac-Man probes, or you can see for amplification, just amplification, fluorescent amplifications, or some sequence-specific primers, something like that, you can do it. And this is like an diagnosis that you take care in a viral response phase via the nucleic acid biomolecules, right? You can also exploit other biomolecules like your spike proteins and other relevant proteins, ORF proteins, something like those proteins, you can use it as a biomarker. Those are also direct diagnosis approaches, okay? So even though they are not nucleic acid, they are also termed as direct diagnostic approaches, because you're directly diagnosing the presence of that particular antigen, the particular infective organism, right? So it's also a biomolecule. It's also an integral part of the viral molecule, right? So it could be easily explored. So then comes, once the host immune response phase picks up, so once it is in the infectious phase, at the middle of the infectious phase, the host immune response actually takes, right? So in that case, you will have prevalence of your host immune cell, your host immune biomarkers like your immunoglobulins, IgM, IgG, IgA, and all those things, which could also be exploited, because all these Igs are very specific to your particular infectious organism. So it could give you a positive results also, but still you cannot easily depend, because it's an indirect approach. You are not directly diagnosing the particular viral molecule, rather than you're indirectly diagnosing it by the presence of your viral molecule, your immunoglobulins have been generated. So it's a host immune response. So that host immune response, by diagnosing the presence of host immune response, would easily diagnose the presence of that condition. So that is it's like an indirect approach, right? So most of the serological assays that we do, like your laminar flow immunoassays, all those kind of assays are like indirect approach. Serological, basically they will go for indirect, because you are taking a sample from the host, right? So it's like an indirect host immune response biomolecules, you are taking it as a biomarkers. So it is an indirect approach. Whereas if you directly take the biomarkers that is prevailing in the causative organism, like your SARS-CoV-2, like its RNA, its nucleic acid, or its surface proteins like spike or something else, then it becomes something like a direct diagnostic approach, like your antigen detection and antibody detection. So this is an easy representation. So this is what I was explaining you about all these direct detection approaches, like ELISA, Western blot could be explored, lateral flow assays, in which lateral flow assays, it is very specifically for the viral proteins, not your antibodies. So lateral flow assays could be exploited in both ways, both in direct detection technique and also in indirect detection technique. Okay. So direct detection technique, if you're exploiting this lateral flow assays, lateral flow immunoassays, it should not be said as lateral flow immunoassays, right? So in this case, it is lateral flow assays. You are just diagnosing the presence of your viral molecules, like your viral spike protein, envelope proteins, nucleocapsid proteins, membrane glycoproteins, or lipidic membranes, something like that. If you're going to diagnose that using this lateral flow approaches, then that stage. So lateral flow approaches, I hope you all know. Your pregnancy kit is a very good example of lateral flow diagnostics, right? So that is what we see it in direct detection methods, correct? And also you can go for RT, that is reverse transcription-based PCR methods, sequencing approaches, correct? You depend on various viral RNA molecules. And then, so you detect the viral components directly. So that is what we call it as direct detection methods, right? So then comes your indirect detection methods in which you detect the presence of your host immune response, right? So your host immune response, in the sense, as we have already told you, rather than the detection of the antigen directly, you depend on its immune response, the biomolecules. So in that case also, you can depend on lateral flow assays, like your lateral flow. In this case, you can say it as LTIA. In the previous case, we were saying it as LFA. In this case, you can say it as LFIA, correct? Lateral flow immunosorbent assays, immunoassays. So in this case, you are going to diagnose the presence of the indirect biomarkers, like your immune cells, your immune immunoglobulins, immune biomolecules. So how will your immune response has been taken up? So based on the mechanism of antibody detection, you can take it up. So these are all, to diagnose this antibodies, the presence of these antibodies in your sample, you have to take the sample as serum, right? Rather than the nasal sample, you have to take your serum. That is what we term it as. So most of the indirect detection methods are said as serological assays. But still, serological assays can also be done in direct way, in which you take the biomarker as the antigens, biomolecules. I hope I am clear, right? So this is the difference between direct detection approaches and indirect detection approaches. Okay, so now coming into the serological. So as I've already told you, serological is nothing but the presence of your host immune response biomolecule, that is your antibodies. So in that case, the occurrence, as we have already mentioned in the previous case, from the day of infection, you can see, if you see the overall graph, would have a viral responsive phase up to a date of somewhere around some 10 days or 10 to 14 days. It will take up to the viral responsive phase. After that, the host response phase starts. So this picture very clearly shows you what is the relative quantity of your antibodies, right? And titer values. So you can easily see after the 10th day, it is picking up in both critical cases and non-critical cases. So this is a particular paper, research work that has been published in Nature Medicine. So it's a clinical and immunological assessment of asymptomatic SARS-CoV-2 infections. So if you see in that case, this particular left side image that I'm showing you here is showing it for asymptomatic and symptomatic cases on the relative level of viral RNA. So this comes under your non-serological assays, that is your direct approaches. Whereas the right side image that I'm showing is completely with the indirect, that is the host immune response. So it is like the log fold of immunoglobulins levels for both symptomatic conditions and the asymptomatic conditions for acute phase and convalescent phases. So the total sample size that they have taken is 37. So it's a very reliable data, if you see, because both the sample numbers are very equal. So this is how you can go for detection. So you can take it up in that way. Okay. So for coming up to serological assays, that's we have already, but why we depend on, we say this many problems in serological assays, that is your indirect approaches, but still why we do it? Because of its easiness, its low technical complexity, even though we cannot say it as a nil technical complexity, we can only say it as low technical complexity, right? So how it infects? So this particular antigen has to go and bind to some thing called as an AC2 cell. Then only it can inspect the host cell. So it's like an entry gate, right? So, but still there are some immunomolecules like immunoglobulins could be exploited to stop the entry of that particular SARS-CoV-2 into your host, right? So you can either exploit that presence. So this is what is immunity that is, humoral immunity that is. So exploring that antibodies, so this antibodies will be present in your serum, right? So you take that as a biomarker and you detect the and you diagnose the presence of that particular condition, then that we say it as serological assays. So variations in SARS-CoV-2 serological diagnostic tests, like lateral flow assays that we have already seen, and then enzyme immunosorbent assays, ELISA, and then chemical immunosorbent immunoassays, right? And then specimen types, most widely explored specimen types are serum, plasmas, and then finger sticks or venous blood, whole blood samples. So blood samples could also be exploited. An immunoglobulin class that has been detected are IgM, IgG, IgA, and total antibodies are also detected in cases. So the CDC COVID-19 guidelines of 2020, May 23 says that no advantage testing for IgG, IgM and IgG are total. So testing for IgA are not recommended actually. So SARS-CoV-2 antigen used as spike protein, receptor binding domains, and then nucleocapsid. So this is for direct assays, direct serological assays. You can depend on S1 or S2 of the spike protein, and then nuclear receptor, RBD domains, and then your nucleocapsid. So most abundant variant, so capsid. So these are all some various SARS-CoV-2 serological test designs that people depend on. Okay. So the current SARS-CoV-2 antibody test status is like currently around 190 commercially available serological tests for SARS-CoV-2 have been approved. So 15 with the emergency use authorization EUA granted by FDA, US FDA. And remaining have been submitted for EUA, that is emergency usages. So only 15 has been exploited for emergency usages. And 31 serological test manufacturers either did not receive or submit the EUA. And no antibody tests are approved for at home or point of care usages. Still in India, there were a case before 1 month in which a particular manufacturer told that we have a POC, that is point of care usage test, but still it has not been commercially approved. Because of various regulatory efforts, right? So alternative or non-venipuncture collection methods are increasingly being investigated. So the diagnosis, you have various stages like sample collection, and then sample, you take your bio extraction of your biomarker from the sample is itself a very tedious task. And then to safely transport it to the laboratory. So a normal diagnostic approach is like a tedious process. Sample extraction is a very crucial stage, and then extracting your biomolecule, biomarker from your sample is a very crucial stage. And then taking that or preserving that in until your assay starts is a very difficult stage. And then defining a very specific assay, very accurate or a very efficient assay is also different, right? So in that case, POCs, like point of care usages, could your way, right? In terms of transportation, storing your biomolecule with a higher care, it could be a little more reduced. That is why we explore those type of POCs. But still, point of care usage types of reduction approaches has not been widely explored or not been widely commercialized. We are exploring a lot, but still, it is not commercially exploited. It's not been commercially available for people. So various investigations have been there. So if you are a little more interested in this diagnosis, you can mostly depend. You can do your research work at this initial stage of diagnosis, like your sample collection, transportation, preserving POC types of models. So rather than taking it, you create a new approach of diagnosis. Better if you are
live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasitharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryamen Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators, and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasetharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostic.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay.
Oh. Recording in progress.
Live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasetharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryaman Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators, and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasetharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay. Okay.
Recording in progress.
Live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasetharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryaman Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasetharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay.
Oh. Recording in progress.
Live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasetharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryaman Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasetharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay. Oh.
Recording in progress.
Live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasitharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryamen Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasitharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostic.
Thank you so much, Anita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issue is rectified, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay.
Recording in progress.
Live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasitharama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryamen Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasitharama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope my screen is visible. Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issue is rectified, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay. Okay.
Recording in progress.
live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasitarama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryaman Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasitarama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope, is my screen is visible? Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay.
Recording in progress.
Live the life you have imagined. Good evening, one and all present here. I am Vininta from Department of Biotechnology, first year. I take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries and my fellow friends present here. In today's webinar, we have Mr. S. Rajasitarama, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology from Banaryaman Institute of Technology. He has completed Masters in Biotechnology from PSG Tech Coimbatore. His areas of expertise includes computational biologics, genomics and AMP, plant biologics. He's an advisory member for AICTE, National Innovation and Startup Policy Framing Committee. He is also a lifetime member of ISTE. He has an industrial experience of 2 years from GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals, along with 2 years of academic experience. He has filed 3 patents. Among them, one is for rapid in-field COVID-19 diagnostic kit. The student teams mentored by him have won various national level contests. He has collaborations with various reputed industries and incubators and also involved in various industry projects. And now I request Mr. S. Rajasitarama to share his views on deep dive into dominant approaches in SARS-CoV-2 diagnostics.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
You are audible.
Sir, I hope, is my screen is visible? Now I am able to present. Is my screen visible?
Sir, you have started the screen sharing, but your screen is not at all visible. I hope if the network issues rectify, it will be visible for us.
Okay, just a minute. I will.
Okay.
Recording in progress.